Hey, welcome back to Antisocial Studies. Today we're going to do a deep dive on something that I thought was going to be super boring, but it's actually pretty interesting. And that is on a lot of these new economic systems that are becoming really influential in trading routes in the late post-classical era. So today we're going to talk about paper money, banking houses, and bills of exchange, and how they're different from each other, because students get them confused. They're not all the same thing. First, for just a little bit of context, like things like an IOU have existed for a long time. That's not what we're talking about, right? I mean, that's pretty basic. We've had that since the BCE times. This idea of like, I write down on something or put in a clay tablet, like I owe you 10 sheep in exchange for my wheat, Settlers of Catan style, whatever. That's not what we're talking about. That's kind of a one-on-one interaction. That's not super advanced. And obviously we've had metal currency for a long time. So we've had metal currency since like the 7th century BCE, kind of the pre-Persians invented it. And that's still going strong. I don't know why we still have pennies, but we do. So that's not what we're talking about. Those were advancements that happened earlier that are important and are really cool. But as you can see from this photo of a guy carrying around strings of metal currency, which is how the Chinese did it even back in, you know, during the Han Dynasty and later on, it's not really going to work when you want to travel really long distances. So what I want us to think about when we're thinking about these three economic innovations that I'm going to talk about is I want us to think about how they are evidence of this really complex and massive network of exchange that's basically covering the entire world as they know it, right? So once you have expanded beyond like an individual interaction, I owe you sheep for my wheat, or even just a sort of regional interaction, here I have these coins and you know that I'm a Greek and that these coins are good, right? That's all cool. But what we're going to see now is something that has to work like literally around the world, and things like paper money that we'll get to in just a second really rely on a ton of stability and a ton of trust in like the future and trust in the government systems that exist. So again, a lot of these innovations could be used as examples of the late post-classical era being in a lot of ways like a high mark, like a kind of a golden era of a lot of these Asian trading states. So first is paper money, right? It's invented by the Chinese, as most things are. So the Chinese had invented paper during the Han Dynasty. It was a Confucian scholar who invented it. Now we though have paper money, the idea that like a mostly worthless piece of paper is now actually worth something only because the government says it is. Think about the trust you have to put in your government, right? Think about the trust we put in our government to say, I think that this $1 bill with George Washington's face on it means something, even though realistically it means absolutely nothing, right? This is why when I think too hard about currency, it like makes my brain hurt because it's all meaningless. So with that, the Chinese invented paper money. This is gonna be incredibly useful for very obvious reasons if we go back to this picture of this poor guy carrying around strings of metal coins. If you wanna hop on the Silk Road and travel hundreds or thousands of miles, carrying around those metal coins doesn't really make a lot of sense. And so they wanted to create something that they could like stick in their pocket and that would be a lot easier to carry. But again, a lot of these don't really work beyond your own government, right? Because you have to trust, for example, like if you're a Chinese merchant, you have your Chinese currency, well, you don't know if where you're going is going to accept it. So even this is somewhat regional until the Mongols. Really, like every one of these slides I'm going to end with, and then the Mongols made it better. Really, until once the Mongols come and unite the Silk Road trade and make it to where really there's this massive empire where from China all the way over to like Eastern Europe, it's under the same and then eventually similar governments, these different khanates. Now all of a sudden paper money has legs, right? You know that if you're Marco Polo and you pick up some Chinese paper money over when you're visiting Kublai Khan, you can go all the way back almost to your home state of Italy, and people are still gonna recognize that because of the stability and security that the Mongol Empire provided. And in fact, Marco Polo is, at least by his own telling, the person who brings back paper money first to Italy and is like, hey guys, this is really smart, right? So anyway, this picture on the right, just to reemphasize that, is the printing plate, right? So we have the printing, woodblock printing, which is what this is, printing on paper. This is a Yuan dynasty note, which is what we call the dynasty in China that the Mongols ruled. And it's printed, it has both Chinese script and Uyghur script, which is the written language that the Mongols are going to adopt. the Uyghurs were sort of a Turkic nomadic group that they conquered that were highly civilized and that had, they set up kind of really positions of honor within the Mongol Empire, especially as their scribes. So the Mongols themselves didn't have a written language. They adopted the Uyghur script. And so this artifact right here is a really good example of the Mongols kind of assimilating to the cultures that they conquer and also taking the best and the brightest and the best ideas of the places they conquer and making them even more useful. Okay. The second thing is banking houses, which are banks, right? It's what we think of as banks today. They really, now there had been places where you could exchange paper money before this, but what we're talking about is the existence of a place that in itself, in and of itself, is going to make money by exchanging currency. That's a new idea, right? With paper money, the government isn't necessarily making a lot of money on this currency. If I buy, I'm just gonna use US currency, if I buy $100 worth of Song Dynasty notes, then I turn around and trade it in another Song Dynasty place and I get $100 back, right? The government's not actually really making that much money there. And in fact, a lot of this paper money was really only accepted in very official government places. And so it actually wasn't super useful to anyone except merchants who were able to travel. This banking houses rise up in Italy in kind of the medieval era during kind of the early Renaissance and partly thanks to the Crusades. So what we mean by banking houses are places where like their entire job is to exchange goods for currency and they can make money off of that endeavor. It really gets started or it really gets kind of promoted when Jewish refugees arrive in Italy after they're being expelled from places like Spain, as Spain is reconquering, quote unquote, the Iberian Peninsula from the Moors or the Muslims. They are also kicking out Jewish people. They are fleeing to other parts of the world, the Middle East, and also to Italy. And the reason why the Jewish people are very important to the history of banking is because in Christianity, especially in strict medieval Christianity, Christians could not practice usury, which means charging interest to make money. So if I'm gonna loan you $100, I can do it out of the goodness of my heart. That's what the Christian church, the Catholic church wanted you to do. But really, why would I do that? Why would I take that risk if I'm not really gonna get anything back? What we understand today is that if I loan you $100, and I'm a bank, for example, I might charge you 10% interest, which means that when you pay it back to me, you pay me $110, I've made 10 bucks for my trouble, right? That was not allowed in the medieval Christian church. But so Jews who were excluded from basically every other legitimate form of like employment, they weren't allowed to own land really anywhere in Europe, especially in Italy. And they were really excluded from almost every other industry. They see an opportunity and say, okay, well, the Christians can't do this, but we can step in and serve that role. And so they do this all across Europe. But in Italy is where it's kind of documented that it began, where they would set up in these big kind of piazzas around these Italian city-states. They would sit on benches or bancas. That's where the name bank is going to come from. And they would trade in grain. So basically, they would give grain farmers money. Here, think about it. You're a Jewish refugee. You're not allowed to own land. You know that land and farming is the way that you gain power and money. So you say, well, I can't farm. I can't own my own land, but I can help fund a farmer and maybe make some money off of it. That's what they start doing, which is really smart. And so what they do is they start investing in farmers. They say, hey, I'll give you some money. And then I'm betting that your, you know, grain harvest is going to go well in 6 months. And then you're going to pay me back with interest for my trouble. So it's a win-win. The farmer gets, you know, an infusion of cash where they can invest more. And then the Jewish bankers get money in return, which they're really not able to get any other way. This banking industry in Italy is going to explode thanks to the Crusades, right? Because if you are a crusader and you're traveling from England or France all the way to the Holy Land, you don't want to carry all of this metal currency. And so what you do is you stop off normally in Italy, which is kind of the last safe Christian place you can go. You're going to try to find a boat. You're going to try to find someone who can take you to the Holy Land. And also you might be able to exchange some of this kind of metal currency you have for other things. That's going to bring us to bills of exchange. So bills of exchange are the last piece of this puzzle. They are different from paper money in the way that a check is different from a dollar bill, right? A dollar bill is just money. We all accept that, like, if I have a dollar, I'm richer than someone that has $0, right? And you want to, in theory, get as many dollars as you can. A bill of exchange is a check. It basically just means, like, it's a piece of paper that means I can go to a bank, give them this piece of paper, and they will give me the cash. They will give me the dollar bills or whatever in exchange. And so this really can't exist until we have a system of banking. And so bills of exchange rise kind of around the world. They start off in the Tang Dynasty. They call it flying cash, which is what we see over on the left. But like, you couldn't really trade it anywhere else. You could actually only exchange it for real money at the capital in the Tang Dynasty. And so really only merchants used it. So like, merchants would trade it around, right? But it was like no one else really used it, because unless you were going to be able to go all the way to the capital to get money exchange, it wasn't worth it, right? So we also have Muslim merchants who are using kind of something similar to this across their empire. But when we really start to get this idea of a check or a bill of exchange is again with the Crusades, and actually with the Knights Templar. And here's where, if you really want to start going down some rabbit holes on the internet into like Illuminati conspiracy theories, it's fun. It's probably all garbage, but I get it. It's fun. The Knights Templar are really very important to the rise of our modern economy. So the Knights Templar are these kind of warrior monks, right, that start to send people off on the Crusades, and they also help fund Crusaders so that they can get as many people to go and try to reconquer the Holy Land as possible. And they create essentially the first examples of like wiring money, which you young people probably have no idea what I'm even talking about. But what this means is that Crusaders could go to a bank in London, a Knights Templar bank in London, and they could give them their silver or whatever. And they would get a piece of paper that is signed and approved by the Knights Templar, who had been approved by the Pope himself, right? That said, hey, we're the Knights Templar. We can vouch for this person. When they get to the Holy Land, give them X amount of money in real cash or real currency. And then that crusader, that crusading army, can travel, can get on a boat. They just have this piece of paper. And when they arrive in the Holy Land, or in the last part of the world closest to the Holy Land that's controlled by the Knights Templar or the Christians, there's going to be a banking house there run by the Knights Templar. They can give it back to them. Those people say, cool, I know my guys back in London, and they're going to hand you your cash or your currency or your grain or your supplies or whatever, right? And so I just want us to think about that all of these things really rely on a lot of developments that you're learning about in Unit 1 and 2, which is widespread networks of exchange, a ton of interaction and cultural interaction between different groups, Muslim merchants, Chinese inventors, Chinese merchants, Jewish refugees, Italian traders, Christian crusaders, right? It's like all these different groups are working together, and they're all developing this globalized system that's all starting to agree on the same rules, right? That we're all starting to agree that like our government's sponsoring or backing some sort of currency or money is legitimate. And, you know, as long as we have some sort of stable environment, that can allow networks of exchange to grow even more. And as with all of these things, this gets kind of set in stone thanks to the Mongols. So the Mongol century, right, is the 13th century. And so this is the time when we're starting to develop these banking houses and bills of exchange. We've had paper money for a while. When the Mongols come and sweep across kind of the known world to some extent, they really like set in place a lot of these economic practices so that even after they're gone, they have created this incredibly interconnected, massive network of exchange from China to Europe that is going to really lead to the entire modern world. So really, it's like this whole deep dive is basically, thank you, Mongols. So I hope that made sense. I hope that was mildly interesting. I normally don't talk about economics, so this was like a rare one for me. As always, go check out my website, go follow me on Instagram, and make sure that you're following my YouTube channel or subscribe to my YouTube channel so that you can see when I put up new videos. Thanks. Bye.